Good morning, everyone. It's so wonderful to have you joining with us. Everyone is welcome to participate in our service today, and we are so glad that you are here. I would invite you all now, if you haven't done so already, to, in the comments section, either share a passing of the peace or say good morning and let everyone know that you're there. Because it's so nice that we're sharing in the service together. And a reminder that if there's a part of the service that touches your heart, or any time that we say amen, if you can please just give me a heart emoji, that would be great, because then we are reminded that we're having this communal shared worship experience. Before we begin our service, we've got a new song. It's actually a brand new song. It was just written, and it's called Cornucopia. And the author of the song, he was desperately trying to find a song that rhymed with cornucopia. And as I look through the song, it actually, there isn't any. So, but in any case, you still have a lot of fun in preparing this song. So we're going to sing it for you, just so you can hear it, and then we will sing it all together a bit later in the service. Actually, I forgot to introduce everyone today. So we have the lovely Robin and Brad who are joining us again in our leadership, and as always, our wonderful Diane. So let us begin with our territorial acknowledgement.
Good morning. Here we congregate on the traditional and current lands of the Cree, Ojibwe, Soto, Dakota, Nakota, and Lakota nations, referred to as Treaty 4 territory. This land is also homeland of the Métis Nation. May we strive to live in right relationship with Canada's Indigenous peoples, and may we ceaselessly strive toward our collective liberation from systems of racism and oppression. In solidarity and love, let us come before the Creating One as we offer our prayers, hear holy story, and sing sacred songs.
And please join with us in our opening hymn, which is Sing Praise to God. It's in Voices United, number 221, and it's to the tune of Praise to the Lord the Almighty. And we are doing verses 1, 3, and 4.
Thank you. Please join me now for the call to worship, which is found printed in your bulletin. Your part is the bold print. Now is the time when leaves drop and teach us how to joyfully let go. Now is the time when everything is festively flavored with pumpkin spice. Now is the time when we reflect upon all the many blessings autumn has bestowed upon us. Now is the time that we gather together online and in spirit to praise, to worship, to celebrate, being a spiritual community together. Come, let us worship God.
Please join with me now in our opening prayer. Let us pray. It is good, Lord, to be here. It is good to gather online to sing, pray, and envision a better world together. A world where justice for all peoples is realized. A world where compassion and empathy are the cornerstones of society. A world where poverty is eliminated. A world where we live harmoniously with our environment. Help us, God, to open our hearts to you. Teach us your way of being, so that we may become channels of your blessing here on earth. Mold us and use us, we pray. Amen.
All right, welcome to our Time for All Ages, and I have some special guests with me today. Who do we have here?
I'm Brenda, and this is my granddaughter, Callie.
And I'm Judy, and this is my granddaughter, Nadia.
Yay! All right, today we're going to talk about rules.
Nobody likes to think about rules, right?
But rules help keep us safe. So can you think of some rules you have at home? Things you should do or not do? Can you stay up all night? No. Do you have to eat your vegetables? Yeah. How about, do you ride bikes? Yeah, what are some rules that you have when you ride a bike?
Wear a helmet.
Wear a helmet, good one. What else?
Wear knee pads.
Knee pads, great idea.
And?
Oh, elbow pads too? Yeah? Can you think of any other rules? Well, rules help to keep us safe. And in Christianity, we have one really important rule, and that's the rule that Jesus taught us, and it is to love God and to love everybody. Does that sound like a nice rule? It's really good to love someone. Now, I want to ask your help in teaching everybody a song. Okay? So you all can do it from where you're sitting. It's a repeat after me and do as I do song. So I'm going to need you to be able to use your hands. Are you ready? Okay. Goes like this. I am amazing.
I am amazing.
I am filled with power.
I am filled with power.
And God loves me.
And God loves me.
Like crazy.
Like crazy.
You are amazing.
You are amazing.
You are filled with power.
You are filled with power.
And God loves you.
And God loves you.
Like crazy.
Like crazy.
We are amazing.
We are amazing.
We are filled with power.
We are filled with power.
And God loves us.
And God loves us.
Like crazy.
Like crazy.
Like crazy.
Like crazy.
Like crazy.
Like crazy.
Great job. And I hope you had fun at home too, everyone.
Today's reading is from Exodus chapter 20, the Ten Commandments. Then God spoke all these words. I am the Lord your God, who brought you out of the land of Egypt, out of the house of slavery. You shall have no gods before me. You shall not make for yourself an idol, whether in the form of anything that is in heaven above, or that is on the earth beneath, or that is in the water under the earth. You shall not make wrongful use of the name of the Lord your God, for the Lord will not acquit anyone who misuses his name. Remember the Sabbath day and keep it holy. 6 days you shall labor and do all your work. Honor your father and your mother, so that your days may be long in the land that the Lord your God is giving you. You shall not murder. You shall not commit adultery. You shall not steal. You shall not bear false witness against your neighbor. You shall not covet your neighbor's house. You shall not covet your neighbor's wife, or male or female slave, or ox or donkey, or anything that belongs to your neighbor. Here ends the reading. This reading is from Matthew chapter 22, verses 15 to 22. The question about paying taxes. Then the Pharisees went and plotted to entrap him in. We'll start that again. Blip, blip, blip. It's a simple word, got me. This reading is from Matthew chapter 22, verses 15 to 22. The question about paying taxes. Then the Pharisees went and plotted to entrap him in what he said. So they sent their disciples to him, along with the Herodians, saying, "Teacher, we know that you are sincere and teach the way of God in accordance with truth, and show deference to no one, for you do not regard people with partiality. Tell us then what you think. Is it lawful to pay taxes to the emperor or not?" But Jesus, aware of their malice, said, "Why are you putting me to the test, you hypocrites? Show me the coin used for the tax." And they brought him a denarius. Then he said to them, "Whose head is this, and whose title?" They answered, "The emperor's." Then he said to them, "Give therefore to the emperor the things that are the emperor's, and to God the things that are God's." When they heard this, they were amazed, and they left him and went away. Here ends the reading.
And now I'd like to introduce something very special. This is the first ever performance of our handbell choir, and they are doing the anthem, and it's "Jesus Loves Me." This song was written by William Bradbury, and it was arranged by Sandy Willard Rogers. So I hope you enjoy.
Thank you. Hello again, everyone. Today, for my reflection, I'd like to talk about Scripture. So what is Scripture? Often we refer to Scripture as the Word of God. What we mean by this is that the writer was inspired by God, and that through our reading of Scripture, God speaks to us in our time and place. Just to be clear, it never said in the Bible that God literally wrote any of the words. It has always been understood that the books found within the Bible are a collection of stories and songs and poems and life experiences of people who lived in the Middle East a long time ago. These books have been inspired by their faith and their experiences in community, and also their experiences with God. But the Bible was never meant to be an exclusive accounting of God's will and actions. Some of you might be thinking, of course I know that God didn't literally, you know, put the ink on the papyrus paper, you know, in the books that eventually became the Bible. But you'd be surprised by how many Christians, due to ignorance or misinformation, take the words found in our Bible literally. And what happens when someone does that is that they get very rigid in their beliefs. And they become convinced that there's only one right way of thinking about God or of worshiping God. This kind of all or nothing thinking becomes a barrier to inclusiveness, an obstacle to ecumenism, and a huge roadblock to peace between different religious groups. It is our work as Christians to wrestle with these scriptures, to hold them up to our context and to our modern ways of being, and ask ourselves, how is God speaking to us today through these ancient stories for the highest good of all living beings? During our reflection time today, I invite us all to delve into and to investigate the Ten Commandments. As we mentioned in children's time today, the most important Christian commandment is the Great Commandment, which Jesus taught his followers. And it goes like this: you shall love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul, with all your mind. And in some versions it also says, and with all your strength. And the second part is, you shall love your neighbor as yourself. These are the two guidelines which supplant all others, according to Jesus. So you might ask yourselves, well, why do we bother learning about the Ten Commandments then? You know, if we've got the Great Commandment, why are we following these older guidelines? And perhaps that's for two reasons. First, as a Jewish person, Jesus would have studied and would have followed the Ten Commandments. And so this gives us some insight into his world. And secondly, the Ten Commandments are ancient guidelines devised to help a community live and work together. I think it's helpful for us to consider what guidelines can help us to live harmoniously in our modern times. So maybe the Ten Commandments offer us something useful for living in today's world. Before we begin examining the Ten Commandments, I would like to share with you a blessing by the Reverend Barclay, which challenges us to expand and grow our ideas on faith. Reverend Barclay calls this our soul work. Every generation needs to rethink, to reshape, and renew their relationship with Scripture so that our faith remains relevant to our very living. Rethinking our relationship with Scripture is also healing work. It's something that sets us free from limited thinking, and it opens us up to our extravagantly beautiful and nurturing relationship with the divine. I have included Reverend Barclay's blessing in our bulletin so that you can read it along with me. I find that every time that I look at this blessing, I see something different. So I encourage you to print it out and to put it up someplace where you'll see it again and again. Read this blessing and it will keep challenging you to avoid stagnation and to grow deeper into your faith. So let us read it all together. May today offer you what your spirit needs to evolve, to expand, to unfold. May it stretch you, but just enough, not by force or demand, but through the kind of invitation that one opens slowly, too careful to be rushed. May you be brave enough to loosen your grip on what you know and perceive, on what you have learned from fear or inherited from lineages of cruelty. May you give thanks for all the sources that gifted you with survival and wisdom, perspective and protection. But not let your gratitude unnecessarily wedge you to them forever. Everything has limitations, even truths that have freed you. I'm going to say that again. Everything has limitations, even truths that have freed you. With proper nourishment, we shed and outgrow. Maybe there are some things that served you well for an era, but not any longer. Maybe it's time to rethink, reshape, review. Maybe you're ready to release another untruth handed to you early on, meant to keep you in line, in order, in compliance. What might be replaced with acceptance of your power and potential for the sake of your own becoming and also us all? Your soul work is essential to the labors of love, collective and eternal. Material, relational, and communal repair are all forms of healing made possible by souls entangled in shared longings and commitments. And so may this day feed you and challenge you, surprise and comfort you, that you might have what you need to be courageous, to be humble, and to let your soul grow. Amen. With this blessing now upon our hearts, we are ready to delve into the Ten Commandments. I challenge you to reimagine your relationship with the Ten Commandments. What is the essence in each guideline, right? So if you look past the words, what's the essence that's trying to be conveyed here? How could you express that essence in modern terms that makes more sense to you and connects better with your life? To get the ball rolling, I would like to share with you a revisioned version of the Ten Commandments, which was published this summer by infleshed.com, which is one of my favorite websites. And you'll find as we go through them, if any of them speak to you, or if any of them prick your interest or capture your attention, I want you to notice that. Notice it, write it down, come back and watch this video again and think about it. I want you to take note of this because this is important work. And some of the pieces here that you find, if they really speak to you, maybe you can add this to your list of your revised Ten Commandments, right? So we're both listening, but I want you to also engage, right? Think about how would you reshape the Ten Commandments to make the most sense for you? And if there are any pieces here which speak to you, take them. And if they don't speak to you, then just let them go. Okay? All right. So what I've got here is I've got cards with the original Ten Commandment verse and then the revisioned one. So I just want you to watch and listen to them both and see how they land, see how they affect you. Oh, sorry, I'm going to sneeze. Okay, first one is, you shall have no other gods before me. And the opposite of that is practice loyalty to the sacred. Second commandment, you shall not make for yourself an idol, whether in the form of anything that is in heaven above or that is on the earth beneath, or that is in the water underneath the earth. Remember that every image of God is only a glimpse. Only a glimpse. Three, you shall not make wrongful use of the name of the Lord your God, for the Lord will not acquit anyone who misuses his name. By the way, just in case you were wondering, what this means is to not make a formal oath in God's name. So it's not just how we casually say God these days, but it's about making a formal oath or a swearing of in God's name that's being prohibited here. So a way to reimagine that is, do not use God's name to do harm. I like that one. That's, for me, that's got a much broader way of looking at it. Do not use God's name to do harm. Remember the Sabbath day and keep it holy. 6 days shall you labor and do all your work. Do not allow productivity to dominate life. I know many of you are probably chuckling to yourselves because this is definitely one I'm still trying to work on. So this is an important guideline. Make sure you practice your Sabbath. Number five, honor your mother and your father so that your days may be long in the land of the Lord your God is giving, in the land of the Lord that your God is giving you. So honor your mother and father. And a revisioned way is care for those who have cared for you. Again, I'm drawn to this one just because if anyone has grown up in an abusive household, that releases them from feeling that they are somehow obligated to remain within that abusive relationship and instead care for those who have cared for you. Number six, you shall not murder. Revisioned, it is, do not be unnecessarily destructive. So again, it's broader than just murder. You know, it's a about not destroying any other living thing or living ecosystem. Number seven, you shall not commit adultery. Revisioned, it is, be faithful to the commitments that you make. Number eight, you shall not steal. Revisioned, it is, do not take what does not belong to you. Number nine, you shall not bear false witness against your neighbor. Revisioned, it is, do not hinder justice from coming to fruition. I had to stop and think about this one. So the idea that if you lie and said your neighbor did something or didn't do something, right, then chances are it could be a legal matter where your neighbor is, you know, having to explain their actions, perhaps, to the law or the king or whomever, whatever situation it is. But the idea that you don't want to hinder justice, so it's not just about what you say, you know, against your neighbor, but think about all the other ways that we can either support or prevent justice from occurring in our actions and in our social justice work. So again, a broader concept, that's why I'm drawn to this one. And number 10, you shall not covet your neighbor's house, you shall not covet your neighbor's wife, or male or female slave, or ox or donkey, or anything that belongs to your neighbor. Reimagined it is, do not use power over others to get what you want. It would be really neat for us to share our personal interpretations of the Ten Commandments together as a group. So you are all welcome to join me on Wednesday during our care and share time. It's a Zoom meeting that's at 10 o'clock, and the Zoom code is found in Heritage Happenings. And that would be a great place for us to share our ideas or our questions, and I will have these guidelines here so we can go through them again if that's helpful for you. As well, don't forget that you can re-watch this video, because the video does stay up on our webpage as well as on our Facebook page. So I invite you to keep considering the Ten Commandments and looking at these new guidelines and just thinking of how would you reinterpret it? What makes the most sense for you in your life? And what parts do you get stuck on? What parts do we need to have some more clarity in order for it to work for you? So I really invite you to think about that over the next few days, and please consider joining us on Wednesday at 10 o'clock. But most of all, I invite you to keep reflecting on the ideas shared here today. Whether it's part, you know, whether it's something that we shared in Reverend Barclay's blessing, or whether it's something in the revision Ten Commandments, which has caught your attention, allow yourself to keep pondering and praying about it. Remember that God is always speaking to us through our scriptures. God's message of love, rebirth, justice, and inclusion can be found in these stories and poems, if only we seek it. Good luck with your homework this week. And as always, blessed be and amen.
Our next hymn is called Cornucopia. This is the one that we practiced at the beginning, and it's kind of bouncy all over the place. So just follow along as best you can and have some fun with it.
Oh,
that in this offering plate, it's not empty. You can't see the red. Instead, it is filled with all the good ways in which we support and love one another, whether it is supporting the work of the church, whether it is helping others in our family or our community, or donating to causes which help to heal the world. All of this is important, and all of this we honor and are grateful for, that this is something that we do together as a congregation. May the work of our hands, may the love of our hearts be blessed and used for God's greater good. Amen.
Come together in prayer with the others and our world. Let us pray. God of the living, with all your creatures, great and small, we sing your bounty and your goodness for the harvest of the land and ocean, and the cycles of the seasons, and the wonders of each creature. You reveal your generosity, teach us the gratitude that dispels envy, that we may honor each gift as you cherish your creation and praise you in all times and places. This is a day may be holy, good, and joyful. We pray in gratitude to you, O Lord. We may offer to you our worship and praise along with the work of our hands, minds, and hearts. We pray in gratitude to you, O Lord, that we may strive for the well-being of all creation. We pray in gratitude to you, O Lord, that in the pleasures and pains of life, we may know the love of Christ and be thankful. We pray in gratitude to you, O Lord, that we may be bound together by your Holy Spirit. In communion with all your holy ones, entrusting one another with all our life to Christ, we pray in gratitude to you, O Lord, that we may always and everywhere give thanks to you, O God, for all our blessings and giftedness. We pray in gratitude to you, O Lord. Amen. Now may we share in the prayer that Jesus taught us, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen.
And now let's come together for our closing hymn, which is In Voices United, number 291, All Things Bright and Beautiful.
It's
To share with you this morning. The first is thinking about next Sunday, which is October the 25th. We will be having our next hybrid service, which is both in person and also online. And next week it will be Group B who will be joining us in person. So we look forward to seeing you all then. And don't worry, everyone else, we will have our live stream starting at 10 o'clock, just like usual. Also next week on Sunday the 25th, we will be releasing our next edition of Children's Church, and this episode will be all about communion, but it will also include lots of fun songs as well as a craft, so I invite all of our young ones to check it out because it'll be a good time. And just to let you know and to think ahead that the Regina CGIT group are planning to be selling both United Church of Canada calendars for 2021 and poinsettias for December this year. And they would work it out that they would drop off things here at the church so you'd be able to come and pick it up. So it's very convenient and it's a great way to support our local group and all the good that they do. I believe that they're hoping to be raising money for one particular family to help them out with their Christmas costs this year. So that would be a lovely thing to help support them with. We will let you know as soon as there are more details about ordering deadlines and pickup times. For any other announcements, please check out Heritage Happenings, which is the email sent out near the end of the week. If you're not on our Heritage Happenings list but would like to know what's going on, please just contact the main office and we will add you to the list. And I think that's it for announcements today.
And now go gladly out into the world. Be filled with the love of God. Dance to the song of the Spirit and befriend Christ in each and every day. Amen. Peace be with you.